People say to me, who's the best player you've ever seen? Well, the finest player the record books tells us at this moment is Jack Nicklaus.
I doff my hat to Jack. He has a record in majors that I don't think will ever be surpassed.
I always said to people back home, you know, that if I had to meet the Queen, or if I met the President of the United States, or if I met dignitaries from all over the world, I wouldn't be as nervous as the first time I met Jack Nicklaus.
It will be a wondrous thing if anyone beats his amazing record.
There were just so many assets that he had that all of us envied.
It's done! It's over!
His concentration, his calm, his determination, and also how he conducted himself outside the golf course.
Jack Nicklaus was golf, and that's how I recognized golf.
For the first time in 11 years, Jack Nicklaus was alone at the top in the final round of the Masters.
This is the last one that he hasn't won.
This is an ovation save for the greats of the game.
They're all cheering and ooing and ahhing this man, and if he hasn't got a tear in his eye, he's a tough old coot.
Nicklaus has this to win the Open. Oh, he's got it! He's got it!
I've got nothing but the, incredible amount of admiration for that man.
Even as a child, the competitive urge was strong within Jack William Nicklaus. Sport was his abiding passion, and to reach the highest standard, whatever the activity, was a constant ambition. From an early age, golf became his obsession, and it was clear that this was a young man destined for greatness.
We couldn't deny his existence. He was so good that early on that he was playing with fellas older than he.
I think he just knew that, look, I'm really gifted. However people want to measure that, I don't know what it's going to be, but I just know I've got something special and I'm going to play it and use it to the hilt.
I don't think there was ever a question about the fact that he was going to be good. I think that a lot of us didn't know for sure how good he was going to be.
Jack Nicklaus turned professional in January of 1962. Less than 20 months later, he'd won three of the game's big four, the Masters, the US Open, and the USPGA. The oldest, most historic title of them all was his next target. This is the story of Nicklaus and his love affair with the Open and his domination of major championship golf. The early 60s would become a golden era for the Open, a championship that was 100 years old and reveling in a renaissance that was led by Arnold Palmer, the winner in 61 and 62 at Troon, where young Nicklaus made his debut.
He was like a bolt of lightning, frankly, when he did appear. He was a burly young man, looked to have immense power. In fact, you know, he hit the ball much further than any of us. Then he had that very fierce countenance. Very deadly serious, which wasn't a common thing in those times.
And there it is, a new Masters record in history.
There was no doubting the talent of Nicklaus, but did he have the special talent needed to challenge the best in the Open Championship?
Jack played very poorly at Troon in the first British Open he played in. He really had not experienced British golf to the degree that many of Arnold and others had. It showed him a different form of the game, the original form of the game. And of course, the golf courses were a totally different challenge.
I've always been a high ball hitter. I've been not necessarily the straightest driver in the world, but always had a lot of power. Being able to harness that power, being able to control it, being able to discipline myself to play seaside golf. It's a game that you have miles of room to play in. But if you don't play it in the right place, you get burned.
Jack finished 29 strokes behind Palmer at Troon and suffered further frustration 12 months later at Royal Lytham as he missed out on a playoff by the narrowest of margins.
didn't shatter me. I don't get shattered by disappointments. Sure, I'm disappointed. And the disappointment is not that I lost the golf tournament. His disappointment is how I performed and lost it. Bogey in the last two holes to lose by one shot. That's a disappointment.
Nicklaus was learning quickly that Lynx golf is an acquired taste. He suffered another near miss a year later when he took on the old course at St. Andrews for the first time. Second place there was tough to take, as the oldest of championships became more and more elusive for the ambitious American.
He knew that you had to win the original, the oldest championship and the most international championship if you wanted to be regarded as a complete golfer. I think secretly, and it's only a thought, I think after the first two or three years, he began to doubt whether that might ever happen.
At Muirfield in 1966, those doubts remained and were shared by some sections of the media, even though this was a man with five major championships already to his name.
You know, the press has their own opinion of what they think somebody is. And evidently they thought that the way I played golf, of hitting it up in the air and hitting it long, it was something that wasn't going to be necessary for good British golf. They didn't look at me as a golfer. I looked at myself as a golfer and one that really wanted to play every type of golf that you could play and be successful at every type of golf. And that was why I was so determined to play well over here.
Muirfield, with all its long history, was a venue Jack was familiar with. As a 19-year-old, he travelled there with his father, Charlie, for the 1959 Walker Cup matches, an experience that would prove invaluable in his quest for the claret jug.
I loved the experience since 59. We had an east wind all week at Muirfield. And all during the practice for the Open in 66, we had a west wind until the last round. Then the wind switched back to the east, and I sort of felt like maybe I was the only one who had practiced in that. I remembered how the golf course played and how you had to play it under those conditions. So I had an advantage because of the Walker Cup. It seems sort of silly 7 years later, but I felt like I did. And when that changed around, all of a sudden it gave me the life and the feeling that says, hey, these guys haven't seen this, I have. This is gonna be my day.
Here surely is the last stroke of the Open Championship of 1966.
The Open's always been something a little special to me, and I never thought I'd get the opportunity to stand up here. You mind if I enjoy it for a minute, if I don't say anything?
He did have, and still does, an inner arrogance, but that's given to all the great players. It's an aura of friendliness, hello, 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 and then, but you know in here that he's one or two up on you right from the word go, at least he thinks he is.
We had some fun that evening. I didn't go out and try to see if I could fill up the claret jug with claret and drink it, but I went out and played tennis, enjoyed it, had a good evening with my wife, and was very pleased with what I did, and look forward to the next golf tournament.
But the results and victories were slow to come. In the 3 years after Muirfield, he won only one additional major, and it seems that his work ethic had declined along with his game.
About that time of my career, I really expected to win. I expected every time I teed it up to go out and win. I sort of felt like, you're a pretty good player, you know, you probably don't need to work this hard. And I mean, that's a bad thing to be. You know, it's a bad thing to have that happen to you, to go through a situation where you sort of get a little too relaxed and too confident in yourself. And sometimes it takes a while and you have to give yourself a little kick in the rear end and, get it going again. And, the kick that I got was not one I really liked, because it was my father's passing that really sort of said, hey, you know, you've been very selfish and your dad has been the person who has supported you, and yet you have not returned what he's given you with hard work.
I think he felt like he'd let his dad down. He'd sort of relied on his talent and hadn't worked at his game, and hadn't really done anything, and he felt bad for his dad, really, that he had kind of let his dad down.
Your golfing career is never complete unless you can win at St. Andrews.
This is something that a lot of people had said, but Mr. Jones had also said that to Jack.
So I got back to work, and really the best part of my career really was stimulated by what happened here in 1970. I love St. Andrews. I think it's just the mystique of it, the beauty of it, and you might say the ugliness of it. And ugliness is probably not the right word. Maybe more drab might be the right word. I mean, if you look at the town sitting there on the golf course, this dark gray building sitting on this golf course is beautiful. Or it's not pretty, yet it's beautiful. To me as a golfer, it's gorgeous. And I love it.
1970 would have added to your affection for the place. The St. Andrews win, and everyone remembers what happened to Doug Sanders.
Doug Sanders, I thought, had won the championship, having got down in two from the road bunker at the 17th. Difficult place.
There's Sanders in this devilish road bunker. I get in the road from here and take eight. But there's one of the finest shots in the circumstances that you ever saw. So good, we'll see it again from the other angle. Just watch this one at a moment like this.
And hit his drive up the final hole, and, you know, the championship was his.
Back here. Mustn't go too far.
And rather like Devon Locke never won the Grand National. It was there, but it never happened.
The golfer's dream or the golfer's nightmare, just as you like.
Where were you at that moment on 18 when that famous...
When Doug missed his putt, I was in the scoring tent. I just finished, and I was feeling bad. I said, well, he's going to just have to make this one to do it. I said, I may as well watch. And then he missed it.
He looks at it again. It's going to be a replay in the morning, and he'll play it 10,000 times over again during the night before they start tomorrow.
I felt badly for Doug for missing the putt, but I certainly felt very happy that I had an opportunity to... win an Open at St. Andrews, and which I did the next day.
Well, he's taken his sweater off, so that's presumably so he can open his shoulders a bit more.
It was such a dramatic way it all finished in regulation, with Sanders missing that short putt and then Nicklaus beating him in the playoff and him taking his jumper off and driving it through the 18th green. I was just starting playing the game there, and it had a dramatic effect on me taking up the game.
And everything depending now on these putts. Oh, he's got it.
When it went in, I think that the excitement got me, and of course, boom, up the putter went in the air, everything else. I darn near, you know, popped it on Doug's head coming down.
You know, you think your parents will be there forever, and you certainly don't expect to lose your dad at 56. And I think it was like a big shock. It's like, okay, I'm it now, and I've got to grow up, and I've got to make him proud. And I think he always looks back at that and thinks, this is for you, Dad.
Jack's second Open Championship victory triggered a decade of dominance by the American. Three Opens, one US Open, two PGAs, and two Masters. And when he overcame Lee Trevino in the 1972 US Open at Pebble Beach, the 32-year-old was halfway towards an unprecedented season Grand Slam. The third leg was the Open at his beloved Muirfield, and once again his opponent, Lee Trevino.
I'm just following the crowd.
Every great champion, like Jack Nicklaus, is always going to have competition. But we never overtook Nicklaus. Nicklaus dominated us. We beat him, sure. He didn't win all the tournaments, sure. He didn't win all the majors, won most of them. We controlled him once in a while.
I got a caddy, don't know where the hell he's going either.
Chronic neck pain was the cause for an unexceptional opening three rounds from Jack, but on the final day, the pain had eased and the challenge for the title gains momentum.
Going into the last round, he's five shots back. On the 11th hole, he caught us.
Oh,
Jack said he bawled. I mean, he virtually bawled like a baby. That the emotion just got him that he had done this and he was in the hunt again.
Jack finished valiantly, but bogey par par would only set the clubhouse target at 5 under. Trevino, one shot to the good, was going for back-to-back open wins. But at 17, he was struggling to save par. Call it wizardry, call it good fortune. The ball drops. And with just the 18th to play, Jack's destiny was out of his hands.
He went into the locker room. It's a fact. He sits down, he's taking his shoes off. I had an 8-iron. I remember it like yesterday. Pin was back left. I had an 8-iron to the green. And they said that Jack was looking at the television as I was swinging, and he watched my swing. Never saw the ball. And they said as soon as he watched the swing, he turns back down and starts taking his shoes off. And the guy says, "You're not going to watch the ball?" He says, "I don't have to." He said, "I watched the swing." And I hit it about 7 feet behind the hole. Two-putted, won the tournament.
Well, you know, I think it was the best chance I ever had. And yeah, sure, I mean, I was disappointed from that standpoint. But the disappointment is not that I lost the golf tournament. His disappointment is how I performed and lost it. I really had control of my own destiny and didn't make it happen.
Words of encouragement that Jack has given me in the past couple of years seem to be paying off. I know he probably wished he'd have kept his mouth shut. Probably a couple, but this is the way Jack Nicklaus is. He tries to help as many fellow golf professionals as he possibly can.
I really believe that if he would have parred 16, birdied 17, he would have won that golf tournament. And I don't think there's any question in my mind he wouldn't have won that other one. He would have won the Grand Slam. I wished he would have beaten me there just so I could have watched this. Oh, yeah, sure.
No modern player has dominated the Open in quite the same way Jack did in the 70s. Not once did he finish outside of the top five and was runner-up an amazing 4 times.
He was there. For the tournaments he didn't win, he was there. The majors, the ones that meant the most. How many times did he finish second and third in major championships? Come up with a number there.
I was at Tonbury in 77 to see the big show between him and Tom Watson.
Golden Bear against Tom Watson at Turnberry, when the two of them just went head to head and both shot the lights out.
I think it's really great when two fellas are playing well, they're playing head to head, they're both playing some of their best golf. And it's not somebody loses, it's somebody wins. I never have a regret if I've given it my best shot and somebody's just played better. And that's what Tom did there.
Would you believe that? Well, I've seen many things in my life.
That is the greatest last 2 days in any major I think has ever been and ever will be.
We both played very well. I missed about a 5 or 6 foot putt at 17, which we might still be going if I'd have made that putt.
And I just felt he got mugged.
My dear Watson.
Who else but Jack can get that 8-iron for one thing out of the rough on the right-hand side of the 18th onto the green?
The great man holds it.
Just to make Watson hole that two-footer to win the championship.
This for the championship. Absolute drama to the end. I don't think I've seen anything better than that.
The golf was memorable, and Tom Watson won it, and I had a little bet on it.
Is that about as good as it gets in major championship golf?
Almost. Yeah. If I'd won, it would have been almost as good as it could get.
Saturday, July the 15th.
Overnight, something significant has happened. But the championship has not quite run its course. There is time yet, perhaps, for some suspense.
Different kind of Open when you won there in 1978. Was that an event that a championship that you felt in control of the final day?
I was in more control of that one than I was the other one. I think Watson was fairly close, if I'm not mistaken. You know, I got down to the end, or down the last few holes, and it was Simon Owen and myself.
Simon Owen, third shot, par 4, 15th. Pitch and run. And it's in the hole for a birdie 3, and that's 7 under par. A long putt. Greens are getting quicker and quicker. Lots of slopes to contend with. Oh, look at this, the speed. Oh, almost rushed the hole to within 12 inches or so, and that surely must close the door with just one hole to play.
I remember Jimmy Dickinson was talking to me as we were walking across the road on 18, and the people were hanging out of the rafters and the windows up above on, all along the road there. I had a few tears in my eyes and sort of a very exciting moment. Jimmy says, "Hold on, Jack." He says, "We got a little bit more golf to play. A little bit more golf to play." He says, "You got to get it up there on the green and get it down too before this thing's over."
Quick break of the wrist and a little punch, a little pitch and run. And goes on and on and on.
I guess I did exactly that and won the tournament.
Two putts for this coveted championship.
By this time, of course, St Andrews had really taken you to their heart, and you had a doctorate from the university and things like that. What did that mean to you?
Well, it was a big honor. There had only been a couple other Americans that had been honored at St Andrews, and you know, Ben Franklin and Bobby Jones, and that's a pretty elite company to be in, and to be honored by the university there and the townspeople was a great moment in my life.
As long as a man has to go for a walk on a golf course, there is hardly a better place than straight up the last fairway at St Andrews, where one is surrounded by 500 years of history. It is especially wonderful if you do it the way Jack Nicklaus does.
In 1980, it was the US Open and PGA titles, and then in 1986, 46 years old, on a famous Augusta afternoon, he claimed his 18th major title. His sixth Masters, the legend, was complete.
I hit that putt and I said, "Ooh, that's going to go in." I hit the putt and hit it fairly firm, and the ball went into the hole. I said, "Whoops, here we go."
And yet another roar split the fairways.
What a man.
For the first time in 11 years, Jack Nicklaus was alone at the top in the final round of the Masters.
And to further underline his fame this year, as Jack says farewell to the game, the Royal Bank of Scotland has issued 2 million commemorative banknotes featuring Jack.
I'm flabbergasted by it. I can't believe it. It's such an honor to take a foreigner and bring him into your country and put him on a banknote. That's some honor that I'm very proud of. It's been a long walk, a long time, a lot of years, a lot of great things. And I just felt like this was the place that I wanted to end my golfing career, was here at St. Andrews. I don't know why I feel that way, but I've always felt like this is the home, and if I'm going to end my career, I'd like to end it at the home of golf. I'm here as a competitor, and you know, we'll find out whether that competitor can play through to Sunday, try to do the best he can, and once the competition is over for me, at that point in time, then it'll become something a little different.
Right, here we go.
What a bunch of hams, huh? I love playing golf, don't get me wrong, because I do. There's nothing I've enjoyed more in my life than playing golf and being competitive. But when you're not part of the competitive part of it, it loses its glow. And one of the things which I never thought, you know, I've said it here in the last few press conferences, is that I never realized, even though I've got my family's very close, Barbara and I started a thing, I guess about a year ago, start having the kids over on Sunday with their families for dinner. You know, many families around the world do that. We never did it. I was playing golf every Sunday. So it never became anything. And frankly, it's been wonderful. A little over a year ago when I said I wanted to play the Masters and the British Open as my last two tournaments, and Steve came to me and he said, Dad, if you want something, he says, Pops. And he says, Pops, I says, hey, Jackie and I have talked, and he says, he wants the Masters next year, and I want the British Open, okay?
We kind of rotate back and forth, but he always gets the Masters, and I usually get this one, and sometimes the PGA or whatever, whenever else he plays.
So, okay. You know, I mean, that was it.
The Nicklaus family was rocked by tragedy earlier this year when Jack's son Steve lost his 17-month-old son Jake in a drowning accident.
It's been tough, you know, especially for me, but been supportive and everybody's been helpful, and it's hard to deal with.
It's a big family out there.
Yeah, it is. It's got a good family of friends and support, and it's tough to deal with, Jim.
I'm so sorry.
On a tee from USA, Jack Nicklaus.
I think Jack is the once in every 10,000 year golfer. Everybody says Tiger Woods will beat his record, but you know what? Time will tell. Jack has got his record, and Jack has stood the test of time. We'll miss him, but at the same time, he's got to sit back and put his chest out very high and say, look what I did for the game.
I feel I've known two or three Jack Nicklauses in my life. The first one I saw, who was plump and had the shaven bullet head, and physically was quite unattractive, and then suddenly he appeared, 1970, having lost a lot of weight, and he got a Barbara's hairdresser to do these wondrous things, and it didn't need highlighting then, and wore these lovely clothes. And he, oh, who's this handsome boy? And then, of course, he's matured, and he's now into, what is he, 65, 66, whatever he is, and he's had a few aches and pains and a few replacement parts. But he's into another age, and so I've certainly seen the three ages of Jack Nicklaus, and I've enjoyed them all.
I wish that, you know, way back I'd actually had the guts to go up to him and say, do you mind if I just shadow you for a month, and, you know, and play some practice rounds with you and just watch how you meet and greet people and all that sort of thing. I think that would have been a brilliant, brilliant learning process. You'd have learned for a lifetime in a month, I guarantee it.
Taught me how to be a great loser, just as much as being a good winner. And you know, things like that, that you don't learn from anybody else but the best. And that's just what he is. He's the best of all time.
I'd like to be there on the 18th green to shake his hand and just tell him how much, you know, he's meant to me and what he's meant to the game, and particularly the Open Championship.
You have to admire everything he's done. I mean, he's been the greatest champion that's ever lived in our sport. No one's ever played the major championships as well as him. No one's ever been as consistent for as long a period of time. He's the greatest that's ever lived.
People were wonderful, and I enjoyed it. It was just, you know, it was kind of a blur. It was like 1978 all over again when I won. That was a nice way to finish, absolutely.
And playing with Tom, that made it even more special. The arm around the shoulder at the end brought back so many memories and so many emotions in this sport.
Well, Tom and I have been great friends for a long time and great competitors, and you know, we've actually played every day this week, and he's more emotional than I am about it. I mean, I said, come on, you got a hold of it. You got to make a birdie here. I said, get those tears out of your eyes, you know.
I told Jack in the sports stands that, you know, Jack, this is just a very small part of the appreciation that people have for you, for what you've done for the game, how you've conducted yourself in the game. He's done a beautiful job of that. He's always been the consummate professional, both in victory and in defeat. And it was a pleasure to go around with him. I had a few tears in my eyes.
It's time to hang him up. It's time to, pass the baton totally. And, I'm quite comfortable with that. And I've got a lot of things I want to do in my life with my family and my grandkids and my design business. And, you know, and I'll stay in the golf. I'll be around it. There's no question about that.
There's no question that everybody will miss Jack Nicklaus.